I have created this pixel barbarian, trained him to swing his axe, and gave him something to practice with. And maybe you want to make your own character sprites and animations for your game project. Or you're just curious how I brought this guy to life. So let's go through the creation process together, step by step. Well, the very first step is to get an idea of what kind of character you want to create. I went for a barbarian warrior in the style of Conan the Barbarian or retro games such as Golden Axe or Deliverance, which I used to play on my Amiga 500 back in the 90s. But the steps we will go through apply to any kind of character sprite animation, so pick whatever you need for your game. And maybe search for some reference images to get a better idea of character details, clothing, idle pose, and the overall vibe you're looking for. Once you have an idea on your mind, we can start by sketching the initial idle pose for our character. If you are creating something for a tile-based game, such as a 2D platformer or a side-scrolling action game, make sure to first think about the size of your character in relation to the tiles in your game world. In my case, I assume a tile size of 16 by 16 pixels, and I decided to let my barbarian warrior occupy an area of about 2 by 3 tiles in its idle pose. It is not so important to stay pixel perfect within that boundary, and other animation frames of our character will anyway go beyond that. But it helps to have a rough idea of the character size for determining things like its attack range, which platforms it can reach by jumping, from which height it might fall before taking damage, etc. One crucial thing that many people struggle with in the beginning is the character proportions. So I will show you some tricks on how to get the proportions right. There is actually no right or wrong, because it also depends on the art style you are going for, but with the following guidelines you will at least have a good starting point. Starting with the bounding box that we just created, we subdivide that box horizontally into 8 segments of equal size. So we end up with 9 horizontal lines, with the first and the last line being the top and bottom of our bounding box. You might have to expand the bounding box by a few pixels depending on the sizes you chose. Once we have those guidelines, we can draw our first sketch on a new layer. To keep the proportions in check, consider the size of each segment as the size of the character's head. Again, it doesn't need to be pixel perfect, and you can deviate from it by a few pixels if needed. The shoulders start at the second line from the top. The chest is between the third and the fourth line. The belly button around the height of the fifth line. The legs start around the sixth line. Knees at line 7. Ankles at line 8, and the feet rest on line number 9. Just keep drawing until you're happy with the silhouette. Don't worry if it doesn't turn out right immediately. Remember that it's always better to draw something that you don't end up liking and then fix it, rather than being hesitant or not even drawing anything because you got demotivated from previous attempts. So just keep adding and removing pixels as you see fit, and have fun doing so, as this is a natural part of the creation process. Next, we will create a separate layer for each individual body part. This will help us later when animating the character, because it allows us to move each body part freely from the rest to find good keyframe poses. Starting with the head, you can simply paint over the silhouette in a new layer and with a different color. At this early stage, don't worry too much about coloring. Just pick something that is clearly distinguishable from the colors you already have. Then we do the same for the torso. To speed things up, you can also copy-paste the parts of the silhouette that you want to extract as a separate body part layer and give it a different color, like I did here for the left arm. The axe is not really a body part, but of course we apply the same technique here and extract it on a new layer with different colors. We do the same for the left and right legs, do some final adjustments where needed, and we are done with this step. Note that I didn't pick a new color for the right leg, and I simply took the purple color from the silhouette. I did put it on a new layer though, just like the other parts. And this is okay, because we won't need to show the silhouette layer together with the body parts, so this color is free to use. But of course you can also pick a new one if you want. At this point, you can check if you are still happy with the overall proportions. In my case, I was wondering if the legs are slightly too short, so I experimented a bit with longer legs and a shorter torso. Making the legs too long didn't really work, but a slight increase by just a few pixels looked better in my opinion. I also kept adjusting the details of the legs, the left arm pose, and the shape of the axe. In general, don't stick too much to the initial silhouette shape and always be open to adjusting things when you feel something is not right yet, until you're happy with the result. And once we have reached that step, we can start animating. If you don't yet have too much experience with creating animations, you might try to jump right in and create the very next frame, then the next, and so on until your animation is done. However, this will make it quite difficult to come up with a good end result, because minor imperfections in character pose or motion flow from one frame to the next are carried over and end up becoming bigger problems throughout your entire animation timeline. Instead, a general technique that is very helpful when creating animations is to first create the most important keyframe poses. So before you start creating your next frame, imagine the entire motion that you want to draw and think about how this motion could be communicated with only 3 or maybe even 2 frames. Think about how the same motion would be shown in a comic book, for example. Usually, this would be the poses where the motions are at their extreme positions. In my case, I want my barbarian to swing his axe with a powerful forward motion. Since the axe is a heavy weapon, he will grab it with both hands, swing it back behind him to charge and create momentum, and then do the actual swing forward. So the keyframes to communicate this motion are these 3, and we will proceed with creating those keyframes first. To do that, it might help you to switch on the onion skin feature in Aseprite. It shows the previous and or the next couple of frames with lower opacity so that you can draw your next frame with some more context of the surrounding frames. You can switch it on with this button. Depending on how you've set up your layers, you might need to also go to the settings with a button next to it and toggle between behind sprite and in front of sprite before you can see the effect. With the little arrows over here, you can configure the number of frames to show before and after your current frame, by simply dragging them to the left or right. In the beginning, it might help to draw the next silhouette again, before extracting all the body parts separately. So we'll do just that. So in my case, I let the barbarian lean forward, while at the same time swinging his axe backwards. The axe head is now facing the other direction compared to the idle pose, because otherwise he would attack with the backside of the axe. The next keyframe then shows the attack in full swing, at its extreme positions, with the axe in front and with the arms extended. At the same time, the torso and legs move backwards to stabilize the motion. Take physics into consideration here. Even if you are going for a more cartoony style, it will still help your animation to follow some basic physics principles. If you are unsure about this part, feel free to look up some reference videos or footage of the animation you are aiming for, or maybe even try out the movement yourself if it's nothing too crazy or unrealistic. With our keyframe silhouettes in place, we can extract the individual parts again, just like we did for the idle pose. And again, feel free to deviate from the initial silhouette and adjust the frame where you see fit. Together with our idle pose, we now have 3 keyframes, which already capture the entire motion. Now we can fill in the gaps and add some in-between frames to make the animation more smooth. It might help to use onion skinning with each body part individually. So, starting with only the head layer visible, we can now show the previous and the next position of the head, and we simply create a new pose halfway between those two. And then we do the same for the left arm, the torso, and all remaining parts. The only exception here in my case is the axe, because here I do not need the axe halfway between the two keyframes, but instead show an upward movement first when the character is lifting it to start swinging. In hindsight, I could have probably made this another keyframe in the first place to follow the halfway in between frame concept more thoroughly, but you get the idea nonetheless, I hope. As you can see, sometimes onion skinning might be confusing if there are too many parts visible, so at some point I tend to switch it off and use the cursor keys instead to jump between frames and check the motion that way. So now we have 4 frames and the animation already looks a bit better. Notice that I also played with the duration of each frame in Aseprite to show the idle pose longer than the other frames, and also the second frame slightly longer than the rest. In an actual game, you would control those details from within your game engine to synchronize it with other animations in your game. But to see how the motion works in isolation during the creation process, it is good to do that in Aseprite instead. Simply select a frame, press P on your keyboard, or right-click and select Frame Properties, and fill in the number of milliseconds that this frame should be displayed. And now we can repeat the same process and create as many in-between frames as we want for our final animation. In my case, I proceeded with creating a frame at the very end, between the actual attack frame and the idle pose, so that the transition from the attack back to the idle pose is more fluent. In general, to determine which additional frames you need and how many you want to have in your final animation, consider the following two aspects. On the one hand, you want the animation to simply look good and feel fluent, so more frames are generally better to achieve that. On the other hand, especially when you're creating something for a game, you want the final animation to be fast, snappy, and responsive when the player presses a button or when an automatically controlled character performs an action. So essentially, it is a trade-off between those two aspects, and there's no universally correct answer here. Note that you can also win some extra animation smoothness by fine-tuning how long each frame should be displayed. For example, instead of showing a particular pose for, let's say, 200 milliseconds, you could rather split it up into four different frames of 50 milliseconds each. It also comes down to gameplay decisions. Maybe not every attack animation needs to be fast and snappy, and your game might feature stronger attacks that the player needs to time well because they take longer to execute by design, and the player is exposed to anime attacks while doing so. In the end, this is up to you, and also an artistic style choice. If the graphic style of your game is minimalistic and simple, your animations can be too, whereas with highly detailed and more mature and realistic graphics, you probably want a lot more frames. So here is our Barbarian Axe animation with 5 frames. The next frame I added is between the barbarian holding the axe behind him and swinging it to the front, to give that actual attack swing some more smoothness. And the resulting 6-frame animation looks like this. So at this point, what do you think could be a good next frame here? Which parts still feel a bit off or unfinished? Well, my answer would be that both the backward and forward swing motions stop too abruptly, given the velocity of the motions and the weight of the axe he is swinging. So I decided to add 2 more frames to improve this. One that does an ever so slight change of the axe and arm positions in this frame, to simulate the effect of the axe slowing down from a high speed motion before coming to a full stop. And another frame at the end of the forward swing with essentially the same idea. With those 2 additional frames, we now have an 8-frame animation that looks like this. And then I felt that the motion back to the idle pose now needs one more in-between frame too, so I decided to add that one as well. And this looks like this. Next, I want to give our barbarian something to play with. My first idea was a wooden barrel with some gold in it, but I didn't like how the barrel ended up falling apart, and why would the barrel be only filled halfway, and why even store gold coins in a wooden barrel in the first place? So I decided to scrap that idea and make a cartoony scarecrow with a funny little head instead. And I also added some wooden particles that fall to the ground. And at this point, with all frames in place, it is time to pick some good colors and flesh out the sketch for each frame. I decided to give the barbarian some long white hair, which is a good opportunity to emphasize the force he puts into the swing, because you can make the hair swing around with the rest of the motion. In general, you can add some loose and freely swinging components to your character, such as long hair, a necklace, or some long clothes, to make them move and swing with the rest of the animation. So, frame by frame, and once more on a separate layer, we can now paint over our sketch and flesh out all the details. Even in this step of the creation process, feel free to still add additional frames where you see fit, taking the considerations about the total number of frames into account. I did that once more for both the backward and forward swing to get even more the illusion of a heavy object taking its time to come to a full stop after a rapid motion. To give the axe swing even more force, as a last step I added some smear lines. And this is the final animation of our barbarian that could come directly out of a retro action game or an iconic 80s movie. Speaking of movie characters, if you want to see more character sprites in pixel art for some iconic movies of the past decades, check out this video next. Check out this movie character sprite animation video next.